Hey guys, Iba here with HurricaneX, and I'm back here to talk more about processors from Intel. And it's actually starting to becoming a weekly thing for me, but that's actually a good thing. AMD's Ryzen CPUs lit some serious fire under Intel's butt, and they quickly came up with Skylake X. If you're interested in the performance review, you can check it out right over here. But today we're talking about Coffee Lake. I gotta have my coffee first. I love the taste of coffee every day in the morning. That's what gets me up and running. But you know what I mean. I guess there's that hidden joke. I don't know. I really don't know. Coffee Lake. Actually, you might remember us making a video on explaining Intel's upcoming 8th generation CPUs on the Ultrabooks and the lower-end desktops. If you're interested in more information, you can check it out right over here. Now, even though Skylake X processors cost more money than many of you can afford, and the mobile low-voltage Coffee Lake processors are a few months away, Intel's 8th generation Coffee Lake CPUs are on their way to desktops very soon. And next week, stay tuned for our full performance review of these new CPUs because I can't quite share that information just yet, but Intel did allow us to share some preliminary information regarding these new chips, so let's get started.
Cooler Master Master Key's keyboard lineup is now available in three sizes to fit within your space, with large, medium, and small boards with either beautiful RGB or pure white LED illumination. A little something for everyone. Make it yours with the Master Keys Pro by Cooler Master.
Looking at the high-end Coffee Lake processors first, the lineup is headlined by the i7-8700K, which is supposed to take over from the 7700K. It is important to remember that the actual differences between Kaby Lake and Coffee Lake are minimal from a core architecture standpoint, but these newer CPUs use Intel's 14nm plus technology, allowing them to hit higher overall clock speeds and core counts without significantly increasing power consumption or heat output. This is why with the 8700K, Intel is able to have clock speeds up to 4.7 GHz, 6 cores, 12 threads, and 12 megabytes of smart cache, while still having a TDP of just 95 watts. That's pretty incredible. What isn't so incredible is the corner Intel has placed themselves in with pricing. The 8700K will retail for about $360, which places it right among 8-core Ryzen 7 processors, and that could be an issue for some productivity tasks. It also makes me wonder, what was the whole point with Kaby Lake X? I mean, looking from a raw performance standpoint, Coffee Lake seems to be a much better platform compared to Kaby Lake X, and it's going to be a lot less expensive too. So, Intel, what is really going on? Anyways, back to the specs of 8th Gen. The i7-8700 is basically the same processor, but without an unlocked multiplier, lower clock speeds, and a TDP of 65 watts. I'm expecting we will see this one in a lot of pre-built gaming systems. Like the i5-7600K it replaces, the new i5-8600K is really meant to be the value leader of this lineup. It offers high clock speeds and a native 6-core die, so it should be much better than Kaby Lake in performance. I'm really excited to take a look at this one since it actually costs more than the 6-core 12-threaded Ryzen 5 1600X without offering more processing threads. Will those higher frequencies win the day for Intel again? I'll find out soon. Where things get much less confusing is in the lower-end i5 and i3 product lineups, since Intel has done a pretty good job with limiting the number of processors they will be introducing. I would actually say the i5-8400 is probably the most interesting of the entire Coffee Lake launch for people who don't care about overclocking. It isn't unlocked, which is too bad, but there are 6 cores and a turbo frequency of 4 GHz. That 65-watt TDP could even make it a good fit for a mid-range HPC or small form factor systems, and Intel has ensured it doesn't cost a dime more than the 7400. The only major challenge could be, once again, with AMD's Ryzen family, since the 1500X costs the exact same amount of money, it can be overclocked and even offers 8 processing threads. Yikes. If you really want budget-minded overclocking from Coffee Lake, things stay really expensive, guys. It is only $15 less than the 8400 and has 2 less threads, but the i3-8350K is what you will need. Honestly, I just don't get Intel's strategy with the 8350K. Even the 7350K was a complete waste of money and just resources, to be honest. Now, if you look at the competition, AMD's Ryzen 5 1400 might be a better choice compared to the CPU because it offers 8 processing threads, and it seems to be a much popular choice among gamers right now. It really seems like Intel's launching these new CPUs without taking a look at what's happening with Ryzen, and I guess we'll have to see how all these CPUs stack up with one another when we put them through our test bench. Finally, there's the i3-8100, and the massive $55 gap between this CPU and the 8350K seems to indicate Intel isn't done launching Coffee Lake processors just yet. But if you want a lower cost quad-core chip, this might be a good fit. Even though Intel still isn't offering all of their Coffee Lake processors and unlocked, their overclocking abilities have been drastically improved. Things like per-core overclocking, real-time memory latency control, and extended PLL trim controls are all included, and there's some expectation that clock speeds will be able to reach well over 5 GHz for the K-series part. Unfortunately, these overclocking features, along with the enhanced power delivery needs of Coffee Lake processors and their ability to run at consistent 2666 MHz memory speeds, means that once again, Intel is asking you to purchase a new motherboard. Yeah, I know guys, this is getting very frustrating and that excuse doesn't really add up, especially when you consider the new Z370 generation doesn't really offer any benefits over Z270. All of the platform's primary lanes comes from the processor itself, and there are still 16 of them. That matches Ryzen, but what Z370 doesn't have is native support for key technologies like USB 3.1 Gen 2 and NVMe storage devices. Those can be added through third-party controllers linked to the chipset's PCIe 3.0 lanes, but that could cause slowdowns when compared to the direct access those devices have on AMD's X370 and B350 chipsets. But what I can see is that motherboard vendors are coming out with some really strong-looking Z370 boards. For instance, take a look at this Gigabyte's Aorus Gaming 7, and it takes all of their lessons from Z270 and improves upon it in every way. There's USB 3.1 Gen 2 connectors, triple M.2 slots, a high-end ESS Sabre audio DAC, and Thunderbolt 3. I'll likely be using this board for a complete build in the next few weeks, so stay tuned for that. But how does this all translate into performance? Well, Intel claims Coffee Lake will offer up to 32% faster 4K video editing and 25% faster in-game frame rates than Kaby Lake. Of course, some of those performance benefits comes from the additional threads on the i7-8700K, but it also sounds like these CPUs should operate at consistently higher clock speeds too. And that means someone with an older Sandy Bridge processor should really look into Coffee Lake. Maybe. We'll let you know more about the performance once Coffee Lake is officially launched on October the 5th. Until then, let us know if you're excited about these new processors from Intel. Also, if you're coming from an older Intel or AMD-based system, is Coffee Lake or Z370 appealing, or would you perhaps lean towards AMD, which means, you know, Ryzen and X370 in the future? Let me know in the comments down below. I'm Ibo with Hurricane X. Thank you so much for watching. Make sure to subscribe for more similar content, and we'll see you in the next one.